Hello and welcome back to our course Star and Planet Formation, Lecture 9. Today we will talk about the initial mass function, because in the previous section we discussed how clusters are formed from giant molecular clouds, and today we will discuss how the cluster, during the cluster formation, the individual gas volumes break up to form individual stars, then giving rise to the initial mass function. We will have four sections today. In the first section, we talk about observations of resolved stellar populations. So, nearby regions where we can identify individual stars and do statistical analysis in order to determine the initial mass function. The second section is on observations of unresolved stellar populations, primarily in external galaxies, where we have to derive the initial mass function from the observed luminosity properties of galaxies. We then follow with two theoretical sections. In the first section, we will try to demonstrate a few approaches that try to explain the observed slope of the initial mass function, the power law tail. And in the second theoretical section, we will look at possible physical reasons that might determine the observed mass peak of the initial mass function. So let's start with the section on observations of resolved stellar populations. This is where we can directly count stars. The first attempt has been done 1952 by Salpeter, who studied the stars in the solar neighborhood. And we will discuss the necessary steps to measure the initial mass function of the field stars in some given volume or in some given angular region around the Sun. Because we can count stars, but to determine the masses, which is not directly observable, we need a couple of steps to derive masses of stellar observations. The first step is to construct a luminosity function. The reason for this is because we observe the luminosities, but we need to know the absolute luminosities of the stars, because the observed luminosity, of course, depends on the distance of a star. So we need to know the distances, and this is, of course, also important because we might limit the sampled stars to a certain volume, so we need to exclude more distant stars from our sample. The most accurate method to determine distances is the parallax measurement. So here, typically, a star is observed at two different times of the Earth orbiting around the Sun, and this gives us a different angular position of the star depending on whether we observe, for example, in spring or in winter. This angle here, of course, depends on the distance of the star, and the further it is away, the smaller this parallax becomes. So for more distant stars, this becomes more difficult. And the uncertainties increase, of course. An additional problem is that for the IMF to be completely sampled down to low masses, we need to detect, of course, the low mass stars, which unfortunately are usually very dim, and these not very bright stars are difficult to measure with this parallax method. So when we, for example, look at masses, stellar masses in the order of 0.1, so 10% solar masses, then the V-band magnitudes of these stars correspond to an absolute magnitude of about 14. And parallax catalogs of such magnitudes used to be available up to maybe 5 or 10 parsecs, which only includes in the order of 200 to 300 stars. So this information is somewhat outdated now with the recent catalogs published from the Gaia measurements of the Gaia satellite, who offers a much, much, much larger sample of stars together with their parallaxes. This measurement and therefore allows a much larger sample to be determined is the use of the so-called color magnitude diagram. This diagram relates the observed apparent magnitude of a star to its color and usually has been calibrated with nearby stars where we know the distance. So for stars with unknown distance, their absolute magnitudes are assigned based on their color and the color magnitude diagram. So this is again as a reminder, the distance modulus, that is how the absolute magnitude differs from the apparent magnitude, which is a function of the distance. Again, recall that the magnitudes are logarithmic units and that large positive values correspond to fainter objects. So here is such a color magnitude diagram where we have the color as the difference between the brightnesses in two different photometric bands, so at two different wavelengths on the x-axis, and the magnitude here on the y-axis. So these are bright objects with low magnitudes, and on the bottom we have the faint objects. And we note that we have a pretty good correlation between the color and the absolute magnitude of these objects. There are variants of this method. So, for example, the spectral parallax method, which is analog to the color magnitude diagram, but uses spectral type magnitude diagrams, such as these, where the spectral type of the stars are related to their absolute magnitudes, to their luminosities. Here, as an example for observations of cold brown stars. When we observe luminosities, we are subject to a number of biases, a number of effects that need to be corrected, and we will go through a number of them. The first is the so-called metallicity bias. The reason for this is that the metallicity of the stars shows a gradient in the galaxies, so that stars that are further away from the galactic center have lower average metallicities compared to stars that are closer. And lower metallicity stars, on average, have higher effective surface temperatures and are usually of an earlier spectral type. So stars with subsolar metallicities therefore would be assigned a too high absolute luminosity based on their color, and this would result in a too large distance assigned to these stars. To correct this, we need to assume a metallicity gradient that needs to be determined independently. And the effect is shown here in this figure, where the points are the originally induced measured luminosities here. And the two lines, the red and the blue line, show two different corrected luminosity based on two different assumed metallicity gradients. The radiation from the stars that we measure is of course also subject to extinction, so we also suffer from extinction bias. Dust extinction not only absorbs light, but it also frequency dependently absorbs stellar light, which leads to a reddening of the starlight, which means that more distant stars are appearing artificially red, which would assign them lower magnitudes based on the color magnitude diagram, and consequently their absolute magnitudes and distances are underestimated. This needs to be corrected with known extinction curve and a known amount of extinction per distance. These are relatively strong constraints, and extinction curves are difficult to measure, but the effect is here shown in the right-hand side figure. And it's also shown that this primarily affects the brighter stars. And when we correct for this, we have the dashed curve here showing the corrected values. Another bias that we suffer from is the so-called Malmquist bias. And this is a statistical bias that we suffer from based on a detection limit. And this is explained here in this figure, where the red line shows our detection limit based on the quadratic decline of the luminosity with the distance of the stars. So everything here in the gray area is unobservable to us, and stars close of these close to this border will have a statistical scatter, and everything that scatters basically below the line will become unobservable. So when we compare the average luminosity of visible stars that we observe to those that is the correct underlying value, if we could observe everything, this is shown here by the two lines. So we overestimate the luminosity for a given volume based on these detection limits. And again, here in this figure, the quantitative effect is shown as a function of magnitude. The red dots show here the raw system, and different corrections are applied for this Malmquist bias, and we see here the effect depending on which correction we assume. This also emphasizes or highlights the fact or the strong influence of the assumptions on the final data that we can use. We also suffer from the fact that many stars are not in single system but occur in multiple systems. So there is a binarity bias. And if these binary stars are very distant, they might be unresolved and mistaken for a single star. If these binaries have very unequal masses, so let's assume a mass ratio between the two of smaller than maybe 0.3, then the color and the magnitude that we observed is dominated by the more massive companion. This is because of the very strong mass-luminosity relation that is about that the luminosity of a star depends on its mass to the power of 3.5 or something. So more massive stars are much, much brighter, and so far, and therefore if this ratio is smaller than 0.3, the less massive companion becomes undetectable and is totally overshined by its massive companion. If the binaries are of about equal mass, then the color, they both have the same color, and therefore the detected color remains the same. However, the luminosity that we measure is the sum of both stars, so the color magnitude assigned luminosity is twice that high of a single star. So, which means we underestimate the distance. We can correct this if the binarity fraction of the mass ratio is known. And this will mostly affect the less brighter stars. And you can here see the effect for differently assumed binary prescriptions. So here various binarity fractions are assumed. And this is the effect on the luminosity function. Once we have determined the absolute magnitude, we need to figure out the mass of the stars, and this is done by a mass magnitude relation. So we need to convert our luminosity function into a mass function, which requires a mass magnitude relation. This can be either done by theoretical modeling or empirically in stars where we can determine the mass independently, or by both. And here's an example of such a mass magnitude relation published by Delfos and others in 2000, where we have the mass in solar masses here on the x-axis and the absolute magnitude on the y-axis. Doing this gives us an IMF for stars up to masses of 0.7 solar masses. We also need to correct for stellar age, because when we look at higher mass stars, they evolve off the main sequence on timescales that are comparable to the mean stellar age in the solar neighborhood. So what we actually measure is not the initial mass function, but the present day mass function, and we need to correct for this because the stellar population is subject to variations due to the different living times of stars of different masses. If we know the star formation history and the initial mass-dependent main sequence stellar lifetime, then the total number of stars formed in the full lifetime of the galaxy is just the integral of the star formation history from minus infinity to zero, which is today, and times the initial mass function. And we can also compare how many of these stars are still on the main sequence. And this is the same integral, but by replacing the lower time limit with minus the t main sequence time. The initial mass function is measured, and then we can correct by scaling the number of observed stars by the fraction of stars in that mass bin that are still alive today, so by the ratio of the two. And this is limited to masses below a few solar masses because higher mass stars have too short lifetimes. We can also look at the initial mass functions in like enclosed environments or in environments or clusters that formed together. One example is Young clusters. And this allows, because they of the young age, to also sample more massive stars. Here the approach is the same as for field stars, and we have a couple of advantages. Due to their young age, the population also still hosts the most massive stars, so they are still on the main sequence, which means that instead of the the present day mass function is basically still equal to the initial mass function. The population is uniform in metallicity, so we have no metallicity bias to correct for. The Young cluster is so small and so confined that all the stars in this cluster have about the same distance, so we do not have to correct for a Malmquist bias or for different extinction. And there are additional complementary methods to measure the distance to the cluster, so we have independent means to accurately determine the distance. And we have the advantage that these low mass stars and brown stars are much younger and therefore still much more luminous compared to when they are older. The disadvantages of these objects are the bad statistics. So the closest massive cluster that we can observe is the Orion Nebula cluster, which is 415 or 430 parsecs away and hosts only a few thousand up to maybe 10,000 stars. Compared to about 1 million stars in the largest field star survey or 1 billion of stars in the recent Gaia sample, we have much, much worse statistics. On the other hand, the most massive star in the Orion Nebula cluster is in the order of 14 solar masses. So we reach already very high stellar masses. The mass-magnitude relation is much more complicated because the metallicity of the stars changes over the lifetime. If the cluster is very young, it might still contain a significant amount of dust that makes it difficult to correct for the dust extinction because different members of the cluster suffer from different amount of dust extinction. We have mass segregation, so if it's very young, the most massive stars will cluster in the center and the low mass stars will be in the outskirts. So it might be more difficult to measure the IMF over the whole cluster. And we might suffer, as I mentioned already, from non-uniform extinction. We might also have problematic dynamical effects, for example, runaway stars, so O and B stars, the most massive stars, might be traveling away from their cluster with velocities up to 50 kilometers per second and ejected from the cluster. And we might have gravitational effects, so for example, tidal stripping, that might remove stars at the edge of the cluster from this cluster. So for example, this will be mostly affect low mass stars and therefore somewhat affect also these statistics. We also have the problem that we have much worse statistics and less and higher uncertainties for binary fractions in young clusters compared to field stars. We can also look at much older objects, globular clusters. They are old and therefore lack the massive stars. But we have a large population of low mass stars that still are on the main sequence. So we can study the IMF under conditions that are very different from young clusters. And they offer a good template for studying unresolved star formation. Due to their long lifetime, all the dynamical effects are much worse because stars had much more time to travel away or to be removed from the cluster. When we look at the general results, then we find that the IMF, so summarizing all the observations in the Milky Way, we find that the IMF appears to be reasonably universal. So this is a result from 2013. And we find values of the IMF slope in the order of 2.35. So that's for Liu et al. In this study. With the exception that nuclear clusters have a flatter IMF slope of about 1.7, minus always, of course. To give a more recent update, the Gaia mission, which was launched with the explicit goal to sample a very large fraction of the solar neighborhood stars, and by now has measured the exact distances, parallax, and eigenvelocities of more than 1.3 billion stars. And we have luminosities available for about 77 million stars. So the statistic is now much, much better. And the survey of this data set is basically complete for apparent magnitudes. Here, G is the apparent magnitude between 12 and 17 magnitudes. So this improved a lot. And for the very bright stars, many sources are missing because of the high sensitivity of the instruments on Gaia. The used CCD cameras saturate easily for the very bright objects. And therefore, it's difficult then to measure the very bright objects. For the more fainter objects, the completeness is of course affected by data processing limitations and some filtering. Nevertheless, when we look at the completeness compared to some other catalogs, we have an almost 100% completeness in our statistics for stars of certain of magnitudes up to 18. And these data has been used to derive the IMF for the solar magnitudes, for example, by Solima in 2019. And he found that the shape of the IMF is well represented by a segmented power law. So power laws with different slopes depending on the mass ranges. And he found two breaks at characteristic masses. The peak of the IMS was found by 0.15 solar masses and with a significant flattening at lower masses and a slope of minus 1.34 in the range from 0.25 to about one solar mass. And for higher mass stars, there is an abrupt decline and a much steeper slope of minus 2.7, maybe minus 2.41. So this depends on the star formation history. But this observed slope is much a significant steeper than what has been proposed, for example, by Krupa or Chabrier or even Salpeter. And the reason for this is that these studies have been performed before the high resolution data, for example, from Hipparcos and from Gaia became available.